laws, regulations, and definitions to protect and expand the existing public trust laws, and we must demand eventually the supremacy of that framework over the failing current one. In Europe, they have started a process like this. In 2000, they signed a European-wide watershed agreement where, because all of their watersheds cross different political jurisdictions, where they agree to guard and protect and govern watersheds on a bioregion basis, not on a nation-state basis. It's not without its problems, but it is being tried. So I dream of a Great Lake Basin's common watershed plan that encompasses watershed-wide planning and management, where we could come to common rules on toxic dumping, on sewage waste, on sustainable food production, on groundwater mapping and protection, on commons plans to fight invasive species. And I would like to see basin-wide bans on bunker oil, nuclear shipments, tar sands pipelines, fracking, water exports, including for bottled water, and ocean-going vessel access to the Great Lakes. I mean, these are tough standards that we have to get. Now, naysayers will say, you'll never get governments to agree to this, but I have watched them agree to something called the North American Free Trade Agreement, and I've watched them agree to a cross-border border security agreement that gives away far more sovereignty than you would have to give away here. And I believe that if we cared enough about these Great Lakes as we do for big business, we could find the way to do this. I do want to say, when we use the term commons, that we're very clear that we're very supportive of First Nations self-government rights, and so we're not applying a European notion of commons here. I think that our notion of commons is very, very compatible with the Chiefs of Ontario Water Declaration, and it's very, I believe it's complementary to our vision, so I just want to be very clear that we're not imposing something on First Nations self-determination. So just in closing, I want to say there's growing goodwill to move to a new consciousness to save our Great Lakes. I would love to see this as a full treaty one day, but our starting point, and this is what this tour is about, is in the cities, towns, villages, and hamlets and farms that ring the Great Lakes, and with the people who live on them and love them. The purpose of this tour is to get communities around the lakes, as well as existing community and environmental groups, to come together through the narrative of the commons and strengthen people's cultural and visceral connection to the Great Lakes and promote what I call the right to care. I have a friend who uses the term the right not to know. You know, if you can be wealthy or you can be privileged, you don't need to know what it's like not to have privilege. And I keep thinking, what's the antidote to the right not to know? It's not just the right to know, it's the right, and even further, the responsibility to care. We need to build on the great work of countless national, state, and provincial and community groups that have toiled for decades to protect this jewel in our midst. And we are looking here in Ontario at the promise of the government here to bring in a new Great Lakes Protection Act, which we think would be a really good starting place. And we're wanting to work with you and the communities that we see around Ontario to start this process, because what they're looking at is a good beginning, but it hasn't the vision that is desperately needed here. We must commit to forge together a participatory process commensurate to the challenges of these mighty lakes and the communities, First Nations, and habitat that depend on them. Great Lakes need great friends. In the end, we are their hope for survival. Thank you so much.
I'm going to turn the microphone now over to Kathleen Padulo, Chiefs of Ontario.
Okay, so good evening, everyone. Sibili, welcome. Sibili is greetings and hello in the Oneida Nation language, and I'm Oneida from the Oneida Nation of the Thames, which is located just outside of St. Thomas, Ontario. And my community, unfortunately, is less than 2 kilometres than the largest landfill in Canada, and that's where all of Toronto's waste currently goes.
Oh my.
So, to start this evening, let me go to the next page. I'm just going to provide you with some of the overlying themes that I'm going to talk about this evening. The first theme that I'm going to talk about is who we are as First Nations people, who are the Chiefs of Ontario, and where do we live in the province of Ontario. Then I'm going to provide you with some background information and events, some brief water statistics, some information about Attawapiskat First Nation, which many of you probably heard about in December. And then I'm going to continue to talk about the water and the health and how they are directly related. And I know that Maude has always spoken about that correlation. And I'd also like to speak to you about the First Nations perspective on water. I'm going to talk about what is the government doing, but I'm also going to talk about what are First Nations doing. I'm going to talk about the water walkers and the current situation, what we can do, and finally, a conclusion. Where are we? Who are we? Where do we live? And I'm not sure if you can see this very clearly, but you can go to the Chiefs of Ontario's website, and we have a really fine map there that provides you with all the nations. So there's 133 First Nations within the province of Ontario. We're broken down into four main cultural groups. And so that's the Haudenosaunee, which are the Iroquois groups, and there are six. We're broken down into the Anishinaabe nations, the Mishkegawak, and the Ojibwe communities. Within the province of Ontario, there are also four political territorial organizations, and that's the Union of Ontario Indians, Anishinaabe Nation, Treaty 3 First Nation, and the Association of Iroquois and Allied Indians. And within the four main cultural groups, we also have obviously different languages that we speak and different cultural practices. And so today we're very privileged to be on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of New Credit. And I want to acknowledge that and to acknowledge my friend as well. Next slide. So in terms of some background information, Maude did allude to the tar sands, and this is a picture of the tar sands if none of you have seen the tar sands. And I want to talk here about, how did we get to this state? And I'm not going to go way back in history, but I'm going to start with Walkerton. So Walkerton took place in May of 2001. And at that time, seven people died from E. coli. 2,300 people became ill. So almost a whole town became ill from E. coli getting into the water system. The Walkerton report recommended that programs be made available to First Nations on and off reserve, because I'm not sure if you're aware, but there are no First Nation laws that pertain to water in First Nation communities, so there's no federal act, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the federal act moving forward, because the federal government has introduced a bill. The federal government, after this happened, and the provincial government also said, we've got to start working together. We can't work in separate entities. And jurisdiction, as Maude said, is a huge issue because a lot of the provincial laws do not pertain to First Nation communities, which is on federal lands. Okay. So some statistics. So this is a picture of a First Nation home in a remote community. This is a statistic that I'm borrowing from Maude. Every 8 seconds, someone in the world dies from drinking contaminated water. I was recently at a school in Toronto, and I was providing some of these stats to some grades 6 and 7s and 8s. And, right away they start counting the seconds. And so that brings a perspective to them also. But one of the other unique things that I think a lot of us don't realize is where we are located and where our water comes from. And I asked these group of grades 6, 7, and 8, in Toronto, downtown urban school, where their water came from. Very few knew that it came from Lake Ontario. So I think that's another misconception that a lot of us don't even realize. Where does our water come from? Does it come from a well? Does it come from a lake? Where do we get our water from, and how do we protect that source? So in First Nations communities, there was recently an assessment that was completed over a year ago. It was an assessment done on all the federal water and wastewater plants within First Nation communities across Canada. And in the province of Ontario, I don't know if any of you know this, but there are 45.5% of the water treatment plants in First Nation communities are at high risk. 45.5%. 38.6% are at medium risk. 15% are at low risk. And currently there are 50 BWAs in First Nation communities in the province of Ontario. So those are some, huge statistics when we think of, you know, the privileged few. From that national assessment, we also found out that it'll cost $309 million to bring the First Nation water and wastewater facilities up to the current Indian and Northern Affair protocols. And it'll water, sewage disposal is impacting our water, agricultural pollution, all of these things. And as First Nations people, you know, we're as much to blame as everyone else. We all have to work at this together. So I'm not saying that there's nobody here that, you know, is without fault. We all have to say, you know, let's hold on a minute. Instead of getting our motors out, maybe we need to start canoeing some more. The current situation. So in many First Nation communities, you're still going to go into homes and you'll find overcrowding. You'll find that the resources just aren't adequate enough. And I think, you know, there is a huge awareness that needs to happen within Canada. I think for the most part, many Canadians don't have that, maybe that awareness, or, you know, we get so busy wrapped up in our everyday lives that we don't always think about, okay, I wonder, you know, how these people are living. So unfortunately, there's still a huge, huge disadvantage to living in remote communities in Canada. So we're only to borrow from those yet unborn. And water is a human right. And this is a capture here, a picture of a First Nation little boy. And it says under, if you can't read it, it says, "Do you have running water? I don't, and I live in Canada, and I need your help." So I think, water is a basic human right, and it needs to be protected for our future generations. And in terms of Great Lakes Protection Act, as First Nations people, we want to be at the table. We want to be making the decisions on waters, on lands, and we want to do that on an equal capacity, okay? We want to be sitting at the table, forming an alliance. And we do have a very good working relationship with the Council of Canadians. And we want to be sharing the decisions like we agreed to with the treaties when we all decided to share and to share these lands and the waters. Thank you.
McMahon, who's a director of Waterlife, a wonderful film on the Great Lakes. So, Kevin, please.
Thanks very much. Firstly, I want to thank Maude and the Council of Canadians for inviting me to share in this event and this important launch that they're doing here tonight. I've been a reporter on the Great Lakes for about 30 years. The first environmental story I ever covered when I was in a college newspaper was a story about the Love Canal. And some of you my age or older will remember that was a neighborhood in Niagara Falls, New York, which was poisoned. It had been built on a toxic waste dump. And a number of the mothers in the neighborhood realized what had happened and tried to get action. And they couldn't get the government to take them seriously. And it was only when they took a couple of officials from the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency in the United States, hostage and held them for a couple of days. That the president at the time, Jimmy Carter, took their complaint seriously, declared a state of emergency, and got some action. Now, you know, those mothers were local and national heroes. You can imagine what would happen to those people today if they tried that sort of tactic. So we're in a really different world than we're in. When I first started reporting on this, in a minute I'm going to show you a clip from this movie we made, Water Life. And the movie looks at the Great Lakes. It starts up in Lake Superior and follows the water down to the ocean. And in fact, Josephine Damman is one of the people who was all through the film. So since we made the movie, about almost 2 years now, it's been shown hundreds of screenings all around the lakes. And whenever I've been at a screening, I've always been shocked at the reaction.